share with you how they have helped to develop and work with ministries, HIV ministries in different contexts. I'm the chair of the African and Caribbean Faith-Based Leadership Conference, and my task in terms of HIV initiative is not one that is direct in terms of the one-on-one, but more from a policy perspective. So our organization, over the years, have partnered with PAHO, which is Pan-African Health Organization, and the United Nations Secretary General Office for the Caribbean. We have partnered with these entities in training our leaders to develop policies as it relates to HIV/AIDS. Just to say that when you talk about the African and Caribbean faith leaders throughout the United States, majority of our leaders are not trained in a divinity school, the majority. And the majority of our Caribbean and African churches are independent churches. And so these leaders mainly get their training through conferences or dialogues or through denominational programs. And so they are not exposed to the different public policy training or how to implement certain ministries as taught in a divinity school. So we try to reach out to leaders. For your benefit, I just want to mention a few things for the benefit of the workshop. Some of the issues we deal with when we talk about alleviating stigmatization among HIV victims. Now the question, I just want to say a few things and make a few comments and we get into the Q&A. Now when we talk about stigma, it's a quality that discredits an individual in the eyes of others. Stigma is a negative attitude characterized by rejection, denial, discrediting, disregarding, devaluing, and creating social distance. Stigma affects the way individuals see themselves, and it reinforces social inequality. Now, stigma and discrimination drives HIV epidemic underground, and these are some of the concerns why we have to have training among our leaders. Stigma makes it more difficult for persons in need to access services. It makes it more difficult for them, for health providers to reach those in need. For HIV-infected persons to disclose their status to sexual partners, and the statistics can prove that 60% of men who have sex with men do not disclose their status. Men who have sex with men, stigma helps them to be themselves. When you remove stigmatization, it helps them to be themselves so that they can have girlfriends and wives who they can share their status with. Many people ignore their own risk because they believe only certain types of people get HIV/AIDS. Now, working with the clergy population, one of the things you need to know, even within the clergy population, HIV is a growing epidemic because you have clergy members that are engaging in private sexual activities, so they are married. They find outlets for this. And you find a number of clergy members who are engaging in bisexual relationships. And so that's coming through the home. So unfortunately, you have first ladies who are finding themselves to be infected by HIV/AIDS. Some of the impact of stigma and self-stigma, and I give you a few causes and effects on individuals. It causes fear, it causes ignorance, it causes prejudice, emotions, religious fundamentalism, and negative media images. Some of the effects on individuals that we discover is fear, guilt, feeling of unworthiness, powerlessness, being passive, withdrawn, depressed, isolated, and anger. I recently looked at the impact of stigma and HIV in countries like Nigeria, Tanzania, and other parts of West Africa. And a number of the researchers in those countries have identified that there is a close relationship between HIV/AIDS, mental illness, and depression, and that is grown. So there's a close relationship because of how we treat people. And we want you to know why we are having conferences like these. Because the way we speak to people, the way we stigmatize them, the negative slurs that we pass at them, the way we preach, and many pastors are guilty of telling them that HIV is God's judgment for their sin. And so this is emerging among many Pentecostal pastors and pastors of individual independent churches without training. There is a lot of judgment that is going on within those circles. And so you find that a number of the victims are becoming depressed, and it is leading to mental illness. Some researchers have also encouraged that in as much as possible healthcare organizations, emergency rooms, we should encourage testing. We should encourage testing through different church programs. We should make people feel good about wanting to do testing. We should not preach. When we preach, we should preach love to them. When we teach, we should teach love to them. We should show genuine love. And so leadership, and I'm going to wrap this up. Leadership is the decisive factor in reducing stigma and discrimination. No matter how some of us work hard, Bishop Holloway talked about the different types of churches. You have those that are really laborers and those that are really profiling. But many of our leaders out there, and you need to find ways to impact your own leader to develop policies in your church, because Nelson Mandela, he talks about the struggle against apartheid and that reconciliation of the race is very important. Marcus Garvey talks about fighting for the respect and upliftment of black people. We have to conscientize our leaders, and we have to have conferences like these to facilitate public education and to conscientize them, to get them to recognize the importance of developing policies. And so my job is to focus on the mind of leaders so that they can put policies in place. There's a pastor by the name of Jerry Thacker in Texas who shared his story about how HIV/AIDS came to his family. And he talked about his wife donating blood. And when she donated blood, one of the instruments had HIV, the virus. And she got it. It was passed on to him. And then it was passed on to their unborn child. And so sexual behaviors are not the only causes of HIV/AIDS. And so we have to be careful how we go about judging people when it comes to issues like these. So for those who are Pentecostals, you need to know that many Pentecostal churches believe and teach that HIV/AIDS is God's way of dealing with rampant sexual immorality. It's a general philosophy among many conservative Christians that sickness and disease, including HIV/AIDS, are present in the world because of the sin of Adam and Eve, and because of their own sin, their own disrespect for their own life. I would say, and I'm trying to wrap this up, it is a truism that most people have contracted HIV/AIDS through immoral sexual activities or drug abuse. Certainly, any form of sexual relation outside of faithful marriage relationship can cause the infection. One of the things that the church should always continue to promote, which I think we are not promoting, and Pastor Todd mentioned it, we should still promote sexual abstinence. We should still promote healthy sexual lifestyle. We should still promote faithfulness in marriage. We should still promote long life fidelity in relationships, because these are some of the openings, and this is where we are the conscience of the nation. We are the moral conscience, and we should still do that. Now, I leave with you a few pointers on critical ways to alleviate stigmatization among individuals living with HIV/AIDS. And these pointers are designed for faith leaders and persons within the faith community. One, we should recognize that HIV/AIDS crisis is an opportunity for the church to exercise the ministry of solidarity, love, and compassion through pastoral care and educational ministries in our churches. And that's what these pastors have demonstrated, their practical example of doing these things. We should declare that HIV/AIDS should be viewed as an illness and affirm our belief that the loving God revealed in Jesus Christ does not inflict illness as a punishment. We should teach and preach and live in a way which reflects Christ's call to follow the stewardship of our bodies as God's gift. We should encourage and offer prayers for the healing of persons living with HIV/AIDS. Those who are infected, give insights for researchers and strengthen caregivers and family to love one another. We should minister with love and support as faithful servants to those in the midst of sickness, pain, death, and crisis. And many chaplains, and I see Reverend Cindy Lee put up her hand, hospital chaplain. Many chaplains, when people are dying and sick, these are some of the things that we have to do. We in the midst of their crisis, we have to offer them hope. We should teach and preach in such a way that the fear and appeal to prejudice surrounds this global crisis will be mitigated. We should teach and preach healing, the gospel of Jesus Christ, in the midst of HIV crisis to end the stigma and bring hope and reconciliation to many families that are broken around this issue. And I leave five more critical policy issues. We should support increased funding for HIV/AIDS research. And churches should give to initiative. If your church don't have a program, and every church can't have a program, you should give to initiatives in your community financially to support the work of HIV/AIDS. We should seek to ensure the protection of civil and human rights and adequate medical care for all persons affected directly or indirectly by HIV/AIDS. We should support those educational and technological means which reduces spread of HIV/AIDS. We should work to eliminate discrimination in all sectors of life against those who have HIV/AIDS. And I say two more things. We should respond to the global HIV/AIDS crisis through national and international structures, churches, governments, and healthcare organizations. I leave one fact with you, I take my seat. A recent research I was reading have displayed that here in the United States, we have mostly the Catholic Church, the Baptist Church, and the Lutheran Church. These are the mainline churches that are investing. These are the main churches that have policies that are working with HIV/AIDS. And that represents like 61% of the church population that is doing that. Most of our churches do not have a ministry. A research has also proven that over 70% of faith-based organizations in the United States do not have a policy for their employees in these religious institutions. And so you have people working with the religious institution, but there's no policy on HIV/AIDS. And so when they contract the disease, there's nothing in place. And so, brothers and sisters, I call you, think on these things, because